Welcome to That's Gross. I'm your host, Scott Gross, and in the studio today, I'm joined by Claire Rouillard. And Claire, welcome to the show.
Thank you.
Claire is running for state representative. She's running as a Republican in the primary. And Claire, as I've had the opportunity to interview about three other Republican candidates, it's a crowded field. There's nine people and there's five openings. And I happen to know you because we are members of the Lions Club together. But for those in the viewing audience, they may not know you. So why don't you take the time to let the viewers know a little bit about you?
Well, I've lived in Goffstown for over 30 years. My husband David and I have been married for 40, actually 41 this week. I have two sons, one that lives in Goffstown, one that lives in Los Angeles. I've got three grandchildren live next door to me. We live up on Jasmine Lane. We used to live in Pinardville for 15 years. Our boys went to public schools in Goffstown. My grandkids are in public schools in Goffstown. I was one of seven children growing up in Pelham, New Hampshire, so a lifelong New Hampshire resident. And I'm an attorney, and I practiced insurance defense, defended physicians and nurses for years. And I decided that it was time to do something for New Hampshire, for me, for my grandkids, and my sons, and so I decided I was going to run.
All right. Well, you know, a lot of times a candidate, there's like this epiphany or this moment where they say, you know what, I've been on the sidelines. And is there any particular, you know, issue or anything that said, you know what, I want to throw my hat into the ring here. I want to run for state rep. I want to make a difference. Was there any of those issues or anything, or is it?
You know, there really wasn't one thing. I think that I've always had opinions about a lot of different things, as most people do. I'm a little bit more reasonable with things, though, and never really understood why people couldn't get along, voice their opinion, have different points of view. People ask about them, they discuss things, and come to an agreement. So, not necessarily one thing. The timing was right for me. The timing was right for me and for my family. And I can devote more time to do this, which is a lot of time, even just in this running this short period of time. It's very time consuming, and you need to put everything into it.
You know, before we started the show, you know, you were telling me that you've done a lot of door knocking on doors and talking to folks in Goffstown. You know, what have you taken away from some of those visits? I mean, what are some of the big issues that you're hearing from constituents?
Well, I've tried to do a little bit in the Pinardville area and a little bit in the neighborhood and the village area. And yesterday, we were over in the Pinardville area. My husband and I and one of my grandchildren, we were walking around, and I had made up some cards, and we were going door to door and talking to folks. And a couple of folks were very concerned about the roads in Pinardville and that they weren't being cared for. And I told them that they should contact the folks at the Public Works Department, and they said, no, we want you to do that. And I said, I will do that for you, and I will let you know what they say. So I did that this morning. And I
bet you I know what the response was.
And I got a call. I got a call back from the director, and we had a wonderful chat. He gave me information that I did not know. And I will be contacting the folks, there were two of them, that brought up the same thing and let them know what I found out. But there was that, the taxes, the increase in taxes, a lot of the elderly folks are real concerned about that. The gas tax was a problem for a lot of people, and I still think a lot of people don't really fully understand the gas tax and where the money's going, how that came about. Generally, they feel that their lives are changed, even from 5-6 years ago. But I think the economy is still a big issue to a lot of folks. But the taxes, I have to say, would be number one.
Okay. I have to, before we get further, I have to say that I did see one of your signs, and you did bring one in. And
did.
The interesting thing is, did you color coordinate your blazer with your sign?
You know, it is a girly sign. I will admit that right off the bat. But the reason that Claire Rouillard is not on that sign is because my husband David was the school nurse at Mountain View Middle School for years and years, and I thought, geez, maybe I could get a few votes if they thought it was David, because everybody loves David. So I didn't put my first name on that.
But you put it in orange.
I did put it in orange, and I like that color. I'm not the traditional red, white, and blue, so I guess I'm not the traditional politician, because I'm not a politician. I'm a person. But I did actually think, geez, I wonder what would go good with that sign.
And,
so I would.
And you did match, so I just... I guess I took the silly question and asked it up front. So, okay, getting back to, you said this, the gas tax. What in particular did the constituent or do you have any particular concerns with the recent hike in the gas tax, which I believe was around 4 cents, which
just
was enacted, I think, this past month.
Yeah,
as a matter
July.
Of fact.
Yeah, it. I think it's 4.2%, but right. I could be wrong on that. And, you know, there's a concern that the gas tax is hurting the everyday worker, the businesses, the truckers, which affects every aspect of our lives. Not only the money that you put in your own gas tank, but what you would be paying for food, the increases of services, and everything that happens along that line with the gas tax increase. One of the things that I would like to see happen, and I don't know because I haven't been able to really investigate it, which I will do, is that some of the funds may or may not be going to the kinds of things that we'd like to see it go to. This morning, my conversation with the folks in town was that only a very small portion of the funds will go to Goffstown, for instance, because we only have one or two bridges that are really in need of repair, where other parts of the state have many bridges that are in need of repair, much worse than ours. So we aren't going to benefit as much as people would think we would from that. The state, on the other hand, I understand the 93 and the tourism and making sure our state is in good condition is important. But I think it really hit the purse strings of the people. And some of them are very angry about that.
You know, it's a little, it's funny because this was brought up in another, with another candidate in another show that I did. And for me, you know, I typically go to the Irving gas station, mm-hmm. and the price over the last 6 weeks has fluctuated like plus or minus 20 cents a gallon during that period of time. I have to say, until I read about it in the newspaper, it wouldn't have dawned on me. And I'm not saying that's a good thing or a bad thing, but, you know, to me, it was just like, I didn't know if the 4 cents was just an increase in the gas tax or if it was just simply the normal uptick of gas prices that occurs during the summer months when, you know, obviously there's a increased demand and the supply might be tempered to a certain degree. So getting back with taxes, I know, as you know, New Hampshire has no state income tax, has no sales tax. Again, I'm not asking you to take the pledge, but what's your position on the income tax and sales tax?
Yeah, I think New Hampshire has an advantage in that, and I think that we should not have any kind of sales tax. I also don't think we should have an income tax. I'm really strong on those 2 points. I think that as a consequence of that, and everything has a consequence, we end up paying higher property taxes. And we may pay twice as much as someone in Massachusetts or in some other state, but we do not have the income tax or the sales tax to go along that the other states have. So I think we're probably even. The problem is that we recently in Goffstown had an increase. I don't know if there was a reevaluation or just the voting from the last year, maybe a combination of both. But there were some folks that I talked to yesterday that said her taxes had gone up $450 a year and they're on a fixed income and it was difficult for them and they had to make accommodations for that. And I understand that. I understand the taxes and I would like to try to help folks with that. But as far as the sales tax, I don't think we should have it. And an income tax, absolutely not. I think we can do it without it. I really do.
You know, it's I think it's one of those conundrums that we have, and especially with elderly people, because they are more often than not on a fixed income. I'll tell you, I know a lot of people my age and younger that are on a fixed income because they haven't had a raise in a while. The issue is that there's just one revenue stream for the most, I shouldn't say that. The property tax is the predominant way of, especially on the local taxes. There's not a whole lot of state money that's coming in
right.
from other type sources. So it does, I guess it does disproportionately affect the elderly who are on fixed incomes, because if they own a home, it's out there. I mean, you know, locally, you know, if they meet certain income and asset limits, there are exemptions and
there
things
are.
Of that
there
nature,
are all sorts of benefits. Yes,
it doesn't affect it doesn't impact a whole lot of folks. That's
no,
for
it
sure.
doesn't. No.
Getting to jobs, our New Hampshire economy, although we didn't go into the deepest of deep recessions as many other states in the country. Mm-hmm. Obviously we did see an uptick in our unemployment. Now it was, I think, as high as almost 7% at one point. Now it's back down to 4.5%. So jobs, our unemployment rate is much better than other parts of the country. However, New Hampshire's really not seeing the greatest recovery in the world, and other surrounding states are actually doing a little better than us. Do you have any ideas or any opinions on how we can create more jobs in the state of New Hampshire?
I actually do. It's funny you asked me that question, because I just I reached out to one of the gals that's in the economic development in town to kind of get their ideas on what it is that we could do in Goffstown to create better jobs and keep our small businesses, you know, viable here. And she is going to get back to me on that. I understand that there's some movement with the planning department in town, maybe looking at some areas that are zoned either industrial, commercial, residential, to allow businesses to come in with less property than what normally, or acreage, than what normally would have occurred. So I think that may entice a little bit, but you know, Goffstown has never really been an industrial town, so that there's not a whole lot of industry. I'm not sure that we'd be able to capture more industry. We've got a couple of businesses, but we need to do the small businesses and allow them to come in and work with them on taxes, perhaps, the first year or two, and getting them in here and getting some of our smaller businesses up and running, so that we can create a better environment for businesses here in the town. As far as the state goes, I think that there is movement already to work with foreign trade, and I think that we just recently held something up at the Omni in Washington, Mount Washington, with people from all over the world coming in here, Canada and some of our lead states, on how to work with industries and trade nationally, internationally. And so we are working on that. As far as jobs coming in, I think we could attract more industry. One of the things that I would like to see is, you know, if anybody is incorporated in this state, one of the things that I have noticed, because I've had some friends that have tried to incorporate here in the state, and everybody knows that if you're incorporated in Delaware, you have a break. Delaware is one of those places where everybody goes to incorporate. It's cheaper, it's quicker, it's faster. When I looked online and looked at Delaware's dollars and the dollars that we spend for incorporation, it's not that far off, and I was surprised at that. But what is a little bit different is the ease upon which one can incorporate, either with a limited liability corporation, a proprietorship, or even an S corporation. We may be able to tighten that up a little bit. Some of the e-commerce that is happening in other parts of the country is not necessarily happening in New Hampshire. I think that we may not have the internet in some parts of the state. It's a problem. We need to have people up in Coos County, even parts of Laconia. They really don't have good internet that would allow individuals to either work from their home or companies to come in and say, we can open up, we can do a business here. But I think we need to do more with that. And so I think we can do more. And I think once we get into this and really look at this, I think we can really work to achieving that.
You know, it raises a pivot point for me, and that is, government regulation. Mm-hmm. And obviously, you know, setting up a corporation is a multi-step process.
It is.
And it takes some time to do that. But also there are a lot of other regulations that are required of a variety of different businesses, whether it be licensure, safety requirements, it runs the gamut. Do you have any ideas or any things that you're seeing that maybe we can do to help improve the business climate through changes in regulation?
The regulations, most of the regulations have been there a long, long time. And the downside of becoming a corporation is what you need to do to protect the corporation, the workers. You've got the insurances, you've got all the other types of things that you must have if you are a corporation. The taxes are filed separately, everything is done separately. You can still be a proprietorship, you can still have a small business and name and still file it all under one, but then you have the exposure to liability. So there's a trade-off. Whether or not the regulations for insurance, for instance, or for licensure can be changed, I don't know. I'd have to look at that. There may be things we can do with that. There may be things we can tighten up. There may be things that we can work on as a state to work on the state regulations, and maybe if the feds have come in to do some regulation, we can look at that as well.
You know, you had mentioned before the term New Hampshire Advantage, and that's,
yes,
that's used quite frequently not in the media, political circles, and that's really, it talks about our uniqueness in terms of the fact that we are somewhat on an isolated island in the Northeast where we don't have a sales tax or an income tax, and other neighboring states come to New Hampshire for a variety of reasons for saving on those mm-hmm. types of things.
Mm-hmm.
One of the other advantages that I think we have in New Hampshire is the beauty of New Hampshire,
mm-hmm.
our mountains, our beaches, our lakes. And when we talk about regulation, I mean, obviously there are environmental type regulations. There's, mm-hmm. we have the Northern Pass that's an issue. I'm not gonna really go into that, but what, do you think that New Hampshire is doing a good job right now protecting those natural resources? Do you think we can do a better job? Do you think we're being over-regulated on the natural resources?
I'm not sure that we're being over-regulated on the natural resources. As I said before, everything has a consequence. If you, the Northern Pass, and you don't want to get into it, but I'll use that as an example. If you allow the Northern Pass to come in and we cut down more trees, or we put underwire utilities, or whatever it is, there is some maybe taking of property, eminent domain, and I'm never a proponent of that, but I am if in the event it's going to help for the greater good than I am. But I think that one of the things that we keep forgetting is New Hampshire, people come here to rest, to relax, to enjoy the Great Lakes, the mountains, the hiking, all of those things. And if you start bringing in large industries that regulate the air quality and that sort of thing, that could be a problem. We need to make sure that we do it right. We need to make sure that we do it so that we aren't affected. And so that we do have to have regulation for that. We want to keep our air clean. We want to keep our water clean. So those regulations are important. But we also need to balance that and whatever the consequences are when we get new businesses that do come in. So it's a balancing test, but we have to keep that into consideration. One of the things that I did not mention is our resources are our graduates, our New Hampshire graduates, the kids that go to the schools and the universities. We lose a lot of those kids after they graduate to jobs outside the state. I'd like to try to keep some of that talent here. Some of the folks that go to UNH and the engineers and some of those folks that are the entrepreneurs, start your businesses here. Let's give them the advantage of doing it without the state income tax or the sales tax. Let them come in and do it. That's another way to keep our talent here. So, I mean, there's a lot of ideas that I have about the economy and how we can work on that. And I think that there can be a meeting of the minds up in Concord and in the state.
Well, I appreciate that segue. You know, as you know, I have two daughters. One's in college. One is hopefully on her way to college. And mm-hmm. you know, New Hampshire has, if not the highest, certainly up there mm-hmm. in terms of post-secondary costs.
Mm-hmm.
Any thoughts on, you know, why you think that's the case, or what we can do to try to, you know, keep those types of the in-state tuition down? Unfortunately, as in terms of my research, you know, New Hampshire, in terms of the funding for the state university system, does not fund as in terms of a percentage wise as heavily as say other states do. But you know, you had mentioned about folks, you know, students staying in,
right.
in but we also have like a one of the highest student loan debt
we
per
do.
Student. And that's another reason why sometimes they go for greener pastures. They have to work in Boston or go to New York or other places with a lower cost of living
to pay off their
to
debt.
Pay them off.
Well, the university system, in-state tuition in New Hampshire is very steep. I had one son that went to in-state schools and then went off to go to get his master's out of state. I had one son that tried it in New Hampshire and left the state, and he got a great education. One of the problems is, and you know how every time in the newspaper they'll have the state jobs and then the salaries.
Right.
What I've noticed on those salaries, a lot of them are with the university system, the very high salaries. I haven't researched this and I haven't really investigated it, but it seems to me that we have a lot of very good professors. We want to attract the talent, but we want to make sure that those professors are teaching a lot and not just a couple of courses now and then. We want to make sure that we utilize them. We may need to look at what we are spending for our professors, for our schools, and maybe trim some of that if we can, or give the advantage and lower in-state tuition to our students. There was something that I had just read about allowing, and there was actually it was a House bill that would allow individuals that declared New Hampshire as their voter registration to get in-state tuition. All that does is pass, it dilutes the money going to the university and makes our true in-state students
right.
pay more money.
Yeah.
So that was a concern of mine, and that bothered me just a little bit, because any student can claim they're going to be voting here and then get in-state tuition. I don't think that was the right thing to do. So we need to be revisiting all of that to see where our student.
What are your thoughts now? If we pivot also backwards in terms of K through 12 type education, New Hampshire overall is ranked pretty high in the country. Overall, are you satisfied with the public education system and the ability of charter schools, or do you like to see more charter schools? What's your take on that?
You know, I'm kind of on the fence on this. I really think that our public schools are pretty good. My boys both went to public school. I went to public schools. My husband went to public schools. New Hampshire overall has got good public schools. It's the parents have to stay involved to make sure that your kids are on track, choose the curriculum wisely, especially when they get into the, you know, secondary schools, high school, and that sort of thing. Be involved with the kids, and I think when you have the partnership with the parents and the teachers, the schools are going to excel. Charter schools are also an option. I think that people need to have a choice whether they have a charter school or a public school. I've always been for choice, so that is important. So I don't know. I think our schools are good. I think Goffstown was actually ranked fifth in the state, the Goffstown High School, recently, and I was happy to see that. I could be off on the number a little bit.
No,
it might have been
right.
I think
it was,
fifth or sixth.
Yeah.
And I was happy to see that. So we've got to be doing something right. And so I think we need to take care of our public schools. I think it's real important to do that.
All right. Well, we've covered a lot of territory in the last course of the last half hour. So do you have anything that you want to let the Goffstown voters know about you, or maybe why they should be voting for you?
Well, I would like them to consider voting for me because I'm a little bit different, I think, than a lot of folks. Different in that.
In what respect? What separates you from the other, there's nine candidates, so there's eight others.
Well, first of all, I'll show up to vote. That's the first thing. We've got some candidates that, for whatever reason, are unable to do that. And so I will show up to vote. That's number one. I have more of a sensible approach, I think, a reasonable approach to things. And as we've taught our children, that if you do this, there's a consequence to this. Everything we do, there is going to be a consequence for our grandkids, our kids. And I need to investigate every single thing that we're going to be voting on. What will the consequence be to Goffstown, the state, if this bill passes? That's what I would bring to the table. I will work hard. I will work steady. I will be professional. And I think we need to bring the professionalism back into Concord, bring the Republicans and the Democrats who have very different views. I'm fiscally conservative, very fiscally conservative, and I want to keep that. But we can work together and come someplace to get where we both agree we've made a good deal, but had to give something up to get the good deal. That's what we do in law. That's what we do in mediation. That's what we can do in the State House. I think we can do it.
All right. Well, thank you so much, Claire.
Thank you.
It was a pleasure speaking with you, and I wish you the best of luck on September 9th. So very important for everyone to get out to vote on September 9th. Again, there's a primary for not only the Republicans, but also the Democrats. If you are an undeclared or you're an independent, you can choose either ballot, I'm told, a Republican or a Democrat, so you can elect at that when you go in to vote at the time. So thanks again, Claire. I wish you the best of luck.
Thank you.
And thank you, the viewing audience. Welcome. Again, welcome. And we'll see you on the next show of That's Gross.